concerned students who are interested in debating and discussing and engaging with issues that are not typically talked about on campus, issues that are suppressed or sort of ignored. And that's why that's one of the main reasons why we're inviting you all to this event, and we're welcoming you to discuss the United States impending or questionable logics in terms of their relationship with Syria and
the intervention.
There you go. So first we are going to be introducing Inderpal.
Inderpal Grewal is a professor of women's gender and sexuality studies at Yale, and a key figure in the discipline. Each of our speakers will be talking for 15 minutes. After that, we'll hear from Bassam Haddad, who is a professor of political economy and a director of Arab studies at George Mason University in DC, and a co-founder of the influential online magazine Jadaliyya. And then followed by Vijay Prashad, who's joining us by Skype from the American University of Beirut, where he is the Edward Said Chair currently. And usually he is at Trinity College here in Connecticut, where he is a director of South Asian History. So first, I think we'll begin with Okay, we'll be doing this.
Because he's late in Beirut, poor guy.
Yeah. It's 11:30 in Beirut. So we'll begin with Professor Grewal.
Attacks, the weapons of mass destruction, as they're called, is presented as a reason for another bombing campaign. Scholarly analysis of the concept of just war and humanitarian wars has come to be a minor industry right now. But some of the critique does not seem, but not much of the critique actually seems to pervade debates regarding war and the current debates about Syria. In a speech last week, President Obama mentioned the deaths of children as one reason why he had decided that the U.S. should intervene in Syria. And this was not the first time he had mentioned the deaths of children, the gas, poison gas. As some commentators have pointed out, such considerations have not prevented drone attacks and other bombing campaigns. So it is with a great deal of skepticism that we hear these concerns for Syrian children. And remember that George Bush only mentioned saving Afghan women in Afghanistan as a preliminary leading up to the war against the bombing of Afghanistan after 9/11. So we can remember some of these, so saving the children resonates through the NGO events, the Save the Children Fund, a project that creates humanitarianism in the West. But deaths of children are always monstrous. But when some are picked out to advance war while others ignored, then we have to ask questions. Extensive research by social science, humanities, and cultural studies scholars has revealed that the figure of the child has long signified a variety of desires, fears, ideologies, and insecurities, and it has been used to move political projects as well as to set prides. Justifications for bombing countries in the Middle East and South Asia no longer, as you all may have noticed, mentions democratization, and the U.S. seems to have lost interest in regime change. And strangely enough, we also have cuts in the military for the first time. But ideas of humanitarian aid, protection, saving are still considered reasons for waging war, even as so many have lost faith that war will work to protect rather than destroy. And it seems as if saving is one part of this project of war, and security has become the other. But what are the costs of these wars? In recent months, some of this information has come to be public and talked about in the news. While the immense costs of war in Iraq and Afghanistan have made many U.S. people in the U.S. skittish about taking on another, new attention has come to focus on the immense costs of medical care and disability from veterans of these wars. Yesterday's New York Times review pages, including a column by Frank Rooney, that mentioned how much medical care for mental and physical problems for veterans is now required. He references David Finkel's book, Thank You for Your Service, in which Finkel reveals the difficulties that veterans run into in readjusting to civilian life, and the injuries, mental and physical, that they carry. Finkel refers to the difficulty they face negotiating the Department of Veterans Affairs, for instance, as they seek to get help. There's now ample criticism of the Veterans Administration and the government in processing claims by veterans and their families. Feminist scholars have long examined how family violence is one forgotten aspect of militarism. And this is also forgotten when the costs of war are understood simply in terms of what happens to soldiers on the battlefield. Right? When we call, we just count the number of soldiers who have died, American soldiers who have died. Even if we look just at the American side, don't we look at what has happened to people in Afghanistan and in Europe. A recent front page article in the LA Times has covered this story. It has a long essay and an essay with accompanying photographs, and it's called A Soldier's Wife, written by Christopher Goffert and photographs by Rick Loomis. It follows how war comes home to one family. The photograph essay shows how families are destroyed by one soldier's PTSD, and showing how the violence of war extends to family, children, and a whole circle of people in the community. And I urge you to look at this. It's called A Soldier's Story, and it's A Soldier's Wife, and it's really the photographs are worth looking at. Such narratives are important, but may not often be considered as the costs of war as they should be. Counting simply soldiers' deaths is thus not defense contractors. Of course, the cost of wars, as you all know, don't list the cost of war to Iran, these are Afghanis, people on the ground. And even violence on, in Afghanistan, for instance, much of the talk of violence against women in Afghanistan is put down as a problem of culture, rather than the exacerbated impact of 30 years of war in that region. Perhaps collateral damage is giving cause to Obama, which is why the phrase, no boots on the ground, is being uttered so many times. Bombs on the ground seem to be getting not the matter, though, since it may be that the cost of bombs that fall in Syria may not matter to the U.S. and may even be useful for the defense industry. What is interesting, we don't hear this phrase, bombs on the ground, a phrase that might just evoke the destruction that these cause, destruction and violence that's often not contained to the right persons targeted or contained to the right location, as evidence caused by the drones. What is being sold to us is the idea that bomb can be so accurate that it would affect only us by its precision strikes. The contrast then between the boots on the ground and the bombs on the ground is something we need to consider, right? And the comparison is what suggests that what we need to be behind is this notion of bombs that come with this air power, the U.S.'s technological superiority. Air power, as Karen Kaplan, Paul Grillo, many others have argued, has a long history in the empire. So as Karen Kaplan says, the view from the air, vertical or oblique, as a target is approached, has become one of the primary ways in which war can be seen by those at a distance. And many of the photographs of war are now shown to us from war at a distance. As we engage in this operation, she continues, the precision, speed, and power of weaponry is mythologized as a promise of objective truth offered by the vertical scale of war waged from the air. Not only does then the view from the air become a way of seeing that we are all asked to share, right? The no boots on the ground once again forgets any other way of seeing except from the air. The view from above, the emphasis on technology and precision, that the technovision will only produce the correct and contained target. These are ideologies that have come to structure what Paul Aurelio has argued as a change in the nature of the visual in the context of the new wars of the late 20th and 21st century. What Kaplan also emphasizes is that these are histories that are embedded in empire and that have come from a longer project of Western visual culture. But all of these scholars of visuality, technology, militarism, Berilio, E.R. Weitzman, Nick Mirzoff, Doug Kellner, and Kaplan, Jennifer Terry, tell us that what Obama and Kerry are offering us, the precision bombing campaign, comes not only with the political economy of war, but with a way of seeing into which we are all integrated. So if one part of the logic of imperial war is saving, the other, I would argue, is security, right? Security is being offered to us as a trade-off for surveillance. Inaugurated after 9/11, a period when the general public consented to the surveillance of Muslims, there wasn't a big outcry about that, as there is an outcry about the kind of surveillance of pretty much everybody that we're not hearing because of the leaks and Snowden and others. Well, these have outraged even those who did not protest the surveillance of Muslim Americans. If imperial ways of seeing allow us to imagine targets of air power as distant and precise, the project of surveillance has entered everyday life in the U.S. This false trade-off, as Daniel Solov calls it, between privacy and security is enabled by surveillance technology that suggests it's important to be transparent, to have nothing to hide, unlike a terrorist, an undocumented worker. So much technology is geared to extract personal information as a commodity while suggesting we can control it. These technologies suggest that we need to give up valuing privacy, that privacy is simply not possible in this day and age, and it's some of the results of persons moving from the government service in the NSA or surveillance sector to developing and creating software companies for everyday use. Such software enables surveillance technology to be part of everyday life, for parents to surveil their children, for bosses to surveil employees, for parents of new babies to surveil what's happening in the home with a nanny, neighbors to surveil each other, and the missus and us. It's now well known that anti-terror legislation such as the Patriot Act have enabled greater government surveillance with fewer restrictions for the courts. While the trade-off offered is security for surveillance, what is also taking place is reduction of welfare and increase of securitization as characteristic of the neoliberal security state. But even before 9/11, the logic of the security state in the US has meant that children and adults come under surveillance in even more areas of social life. For instance, teenagers are subject to curfews in many cities that ban them from being in the streets after 11 p.m. Schools have metal detectors, police, and zero tolerance policies, as they call them, mandatory drug tests, searches, all of which are enforced in draconian ways, especially on children of color. Inner city schools have so much more invasive surveillance than children in more affluent schools. Military recruiters and police officers in schools with more minority children have greater power and access to these students, thus getting them used to an early connection with both the military and the criminal justice system, producing what Torin Monaghan calls a system of sorting children along lines of class, race, and gender. Such sorting is especially a characteristic of neoliberal policies that provide surveillance systems to schools while they may not have, as Monaghan has pointed out, proper furniture or books or teachers. Not only, again, even middle-class children can be surveilled by new medical technologies, but they have gadgets and toys that encourage them to surveil each other as well. So far, I've talked about saving and surveilling as two key instruments of the imperial state. I want to end with a brief thought about academic knowledge production. Much of what I have said comes from research of colleagues and experts in a bunch of interrelated fields, visual studies, intellectual histories, cultural studies, cultural geography, feminist studies, American studies, that are united in their efforts to understand how social relations and ways of seeing are central aspects of understanding militarized societies, such as ours. Human vision, identities, racial difference, gender, changing relations between economic and technological formations have been key here. But very little of this work seems to be influencing geopolitics and experts in international relations, for instance. Feminist scholars in international relations have worked really hard to change that. They have produced what one scholar calls the international relations as if people matter, a scholarship that begins with individuals, families, and communities rather than with military, defense industry, and states as coherent, top-down, unified entities. Postcolonial studies has questioned the notion of national elites who stand in for the nation and has critiqued the ideal West as a coherent entity, seeing it instead as an ideological and ongoing process. Critical race scholarship has questioned racial logics at the heart of what is called the racial state. The idea of the political rather than simply politics has come to be an urgent area of research as a new field not security, but securitization studies. The realist and idealist international relations tradition was critiqued not simply by feminist or postcolonial scholarship, but within itself, from feminist scholars in a post-structuralist IR that critiqued its elitism, its dependence on positivism, its notion of practical knowledge, and its immense power. Scholars such as Jennifer Heinemann, Jenny Atkins, Christine Sylvester, Ashwini Tambi are pushing a new feminist IR that examines international relations itself as a discursive tradition, a form of power and a gender construct. Right? Ole Weaver and others have examined securitization rather than security as the extreme politics that needs our attention, And Jenny Etkin's has argued that securitization is a new kind of form of depoliticization that urgently needs our attention. How do you extend all these critiques from across the social science and humanities into the realm of politics is, however, still an urgent project that needs us all.
Next up is going to be Vijay Prashad. I'm going to try to connect with my Skype. Nick, can you hear us well?
Yes.
Great. So, Professor Vijay Prashad, thank you very much for joining us from so late in Beirut. But you're up. Thank you so much.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me, and sorry, Inderpal, I missed the last part of your remarks. Well, let me put it this way. There is a major crisis in West Asia, and the crisis can be seen in a few different ways. Firstly, there is a catastrophic refugee problem. 7 million people are displaced. 2 million have been forced out of Syria, 5 million are displaced inside. So that is just a vast number of people for a small population like Syria. So that's the first thing to bear in mind. Linked to that, the United States, as you know, puts itself forward as the great champion of humanitarianism. But the United States has been lax on its pledges for humanitarian relief. So for food aid, for housing, things like that, the U.S. has been between 15% and 20%, has made 15% to 20% of its pledges. There are, as I said, 2 million people who left Syria as refugees. Only 33 have been allowed inside the United States. You have to compare that to about 680,000 who are now in Lebanon. So the United States, with its great talk of humanitarianism, of being, you know, a champion of people who are, lost to the forces of the world, has really not met any of its obligations on the world stage. So, you know, in a way, it's put your green card where your mouth is, and that has certainly not been happening. There's been only, as I said, 33 people who have been brought into the United States as refugees. So bear that in mind when I go forward to the rest of what I'm going to say. So in Syria, as you know, there is now a full-blown war. You can call it a civil war, you might call it a proxy war, you might call it a war of aggression by the regime. However you describe it, it is a war. The most recent UN report on Syria says the following. I'll just read a few sentences. It says, as prospects for a political settlement stagnate, the warring parties' willingness to negotiate has been affected by military developments on the ground. Both the government and anti-government armed groups believe that they can achieve a military victory. Their respective supporters afford them political coverage, financial assistance, and military hardware, turning the Syrian conflict into a proxy war of regional and international interests. I wanted to read this out for two reasons. One is, I think the assessment is quite good, which is that it's true. The Syrian conflict, which began in March 2011 as a fight over democratization, in fact, actually, it was just the right to protest in the town of Dara, morphs rather quickly into a kind of regional international war, slightly different from the kind of uprisings in Egypt, in Libya, etc. That's for a whole host of other reasons. That's one thing I think one has to take cognizance of. Because of that, the see people coming from outside, etc. And that is very disruptive for the nature of the rebellion. So, you know, people who have traveled in northern Syria report that there is inter-Sinai warfare between people who are against the radical Islamists and the Islamists. Then there is ongoing warfare between the Islamist groups and the Kurdish popular committees in the Kurdish region. So the rebels have turned on each other at the ground level. At the top level of the leadership, you know, and this is too complicated to get into, but as Qatar has seen its star, you know, wane, and Saudi Arabia has put itself forward as the main, you know, interlocutor, the Arab interlocutor in the Syrian sector at least, in the Syrian National Coalition, the Qatari-backed people have been removed, and more Saudi-backed people have come in. You know, there was recently a new prime minister appointed. So whether it's at the ground level or at the top level, the rebellion is in some disarray. The regime as well has been weakened. It's not what it was, let us say, in 1983, you know, after the bombardment in Hama. It's not quite at that level. It's not even at the level of the early 2000s. It is a weakened regime. So there is a military stalemate. In the middle of the stalemate, the United States arrives to say, A, not that it will, you know, launch strikes to overthrow the Assad regime, but it will use Tomahawk missiles, which the military has said has limited tactical efficacy, meaning it's simply there as a show. And Mr. Obama, on his speech in September 10th, said, you cannot use armed force to overthrow a dictator, or we will not use armed force to overthrow a dictator, meaning that it's not in American national interests to get rid of Mr. Assad. It's the contention of many people that I speak with, I believe this very much, that the aim of the United States here is to bleed Syria, and to bleed it for as long as possible. It is to bleed it to some extent to weaken Hezbollah, which is the only military force that threatens Israel. It's also, apparently, as far as US planners are concerned, a way to weaken Iran. This is a cynical policy. It's not a humanitarian policy. You know, as it is, I've shown you a little that the humanitarianism of the United States can be called into question. But on a second level, even militarily, this is a cynical policy. Mr. Obama has framed this whole thing around duality. Either we bomb or we do nothing. That's the framework of this administration, and the media has taken it hook, line, and sinker. Either you bomb or you do nothing. Today, the UN report shows that sarin gas was indeed used on August You know, one of the immediate things that needs to happen in order to engender some kind of regional solution is for a regional Syrian refugees conference. The UN has just appointed Mr. Nigel Fisher to be the coordinator of all humanitarian efforts in the region. But that's the UN's approach. You know, there needs to be a regional approach from the governments. These countries can play an important role, which I'll mention why in a second. Secondly, evidence of such a regional dynamic comes in the Arab League. Just before Mr. Obama's back, you know, before he had to retreat on September 10th, the Arab League met. And the agenda item at the Arab League meeting was to support the American right to bomb in Syria. But four countries strongly opposed the Gulf Arab proposal, and those were Algeria, Lebanon, Egypt, and Iraq. And they won the day. The Arab League was not able to put forward a strong resolution in support of the American bombing. That means that at least these four countries, three of which could be part of a refugees conference, have an approach that they say is slightly different from the American approach. They haven't yet articulated that approach, but that's important. And the third piece of evidence is the new Iranian government. Mr. Hassan Rouhani has made it clear, he made a statement to the Republican Guard in Iran. He said that we will accept in Syria any leader who is elected. Now, you can interpret this in many ways. One, cynically, that, well, technically Mr. Assad is elected. So what Mr. Rouhani is saying is we back the Assad government. The other way to see this is Mr. Rouhani is just keeping the door open, saying that we are open to different scenarios for Syria. In other words, there is an atmosphere in the region for a renewed attempt to create some kind of regional move. And why I say renewed is last year, a most unusual thing occurred when the Syria contact group was formed, which included historic adversaries like Iran, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Turkey. And when the Syria contact group tried to meet, the Americans and the Russians sidelined them and said, you are not important to world history. We are going to meet in Madrid, the US and Russia, and discuss the fate of Syria. You are not needed at the table. In other words, they sidelined a regional attempt. I don't believe that you should accept the view that either you bomb or you do nothing. There is plenty else to be done. There is plenty else to be done on the front of humanitarian relief. There's plenty else to be done in terms of building political confidence in the region to put pressure on the Assad regime and the rebels to come to the table in Geneva and to create some kind of path out of the carnage that has befallen that country. There are other options. You can close your mind and accept the Obama solution, that two-track approach, either you do nothing or you bomb, or open your mind to put pressure in ways that are, I think, good for the region and would set it.
We lost you for just a second. If you just repeat what you just said.
Oh, all I said was you can either believe the bifurcated worldview of Obama, either you bomb or you do nothing, or you put your effort into trying to build some kind of other solution, whether it's humanitarian or building a regional solution, which is a very credible and realistic approach. It's not as utopian as people suggest. It's more utopian to believe that bombing creates world history. It's less utopian to believe that people in the neighborhood might be able to take their region in hand. Thanks.
So, Professor Prashad, we're going to keep you online, and I'll come up and reconnect if the connection falls. But now
you just walked out.
Bassam S was just trying to escape. Yeah, that would be nice. How about we take 10 minutes of questions since Professor Grewal has to take off at 5:30?
concern that even then, security was the major portion of that budget. But it was the major portion of that budget because of the neighborhood, because of the thuggery that existed. Now we're looking at a country like Syria where thuggery exists on both sides of the conflict. What is the solution to protect a civilian population that are being squeezed from both sides by, you know, because in a conflict like this, it's really the thugs that are going to rule.
I think Vijay might have something to say to that question too. But I think what I will say to that question is that there's a sort of complicated relations between the production and selling of technologies of security. You can see the kind of prevalence of guns, weaponry, etc. And it's debatable whether that protects you or whether that, it's not debatable. I think it simply adds to the violence that occurs on the ground. So I think that there are so many ways that people can take to addressing the situation. Part of, you know, the U.S. Exports a lot of weaponry all over the world. So much of what we have as an economy is also participates in this production of violence. And that's where I get really worried about how are we going to get ourselves out of this situation, out of this system that we have set up. And that's, you can see this even in the U.S. in the kind of ways in which people are talking about putting guns in the hands of school teachers. It's how far will we go with that? It's a dead end. And it's not even a dead end. It produces so much violence everywhere. I'll let Vijay answer that. Vijay, did you hear that?
Yes. No, I agree with you. I mean, how to say this, but yes, I mean, obviously in any conflict that's intractable, the question of irrational violence comes in. This is an intractable conflict where neither of the major parties is willing to see that it's intractable. You know, by all accounts, the regime still believes that it can win. You know, it's fighting a war, a long game, a war of aggression. Currently, the geopolitical situation has favored it, with the deal that the Russians were able to get, so they have a lease of life. They think they can continue forever. On the other hand, sections of the rebellion also feel like they can win. And, they have been backed by forces, including the man who I consider the torquemada of the Middle East, John McCain. You know, the kind of statements they make where they say, we're going to get you the B-2 bombers and things like that, it creates a sense of expectation. And, in the middle of this, it's not only ordinary people that are getting burned, 7 million displaced, but also the people fighting. They are fighting under an illusion, which is why the political process is essential. And since it seems the great powers are not willing to move a political process, I think that's why I repeat it's essential for the regional entities to push for some kind of political dialogue. Otherwise, we are allowing two sets of people to have a hallucination about their possibilities, continue to massacre each other.
Any questions for Professor Grewal in particular, since she has to take off? Take one question. I don't know how well this works.
Since you are in women's studies, could you briefly discuss, there was on social media a photograph of Kabul in 1972 with a woman, young lady students dressing just like Yale students in 1972. And a photograph of today where all the women are in burqas. In Iraq, a marriage was taken out of the purview of the state courts, marriage and divorce, and relegated to individual religious judges. And the same thing is happening in Syria, it seems, or is in danger of being happening. Well, it's happening in the rebel-held area. So could you tell your observations and whatever you want to say on this subject?
Well, first of all, I want to say that the hijab or burqa is not a sign of, you know, lack of modernity or progress or anything like that. There are many people who've written about it, a long history of nationalism, of identity, of all kinds of ways that people use clothing to signify certain politics. So it's a very complex politics that can't be sort of reduced to a sign of anything that the West wants it to be, right? Because there are all kinds of agents in this. So I would say that to begin with. And the second point I will make is that, you know, war, the kind of projects of war don't improve anybody's pathways in life. So if you have a region that has been at war for many, many years, as Afghanistan, over 30 years, right? And for a long history, it was part of the great game of the Western powers in South Asia. So it's been implicated in a kind of crossroads of geopolitical warfare for a very long period of time. And what that does to forms of patriarchy, for intensifies tradition, it can do all kinds of things. That we really need to understand what war does to people on the ground. And the third thing I will say, that the history of empire and imperialism in the West includes a long tradition of picking sort of images of certain groups, certain forms of violence in other places to signify that they are not yet progressive enough, right? So there's sort of the kind of, what one of my colleagues says, the burqa cam of the West was so powerful, has been really, really powerful. I think it's become less powerful now than it used to be. But certainly it's a very evocative image in the Western imagination. And that's a very long history of visual culture in the West as well. So I would say those are three points that I would make.
Just for the record, I'm from Turkey, and I have nothing against women voluntarily covering themselves up, but I am concerned that certain political forces are forcing them to cover up.
Well, political forces are always at play everywhere, right? Making people do certain things. But if you pick out only certain objects or certain clothing as being sort of more significant than others, then we have to look at a historical visual culture, which I was, you know, trying to refer to in the talk.
Hi, very brief, hi, Professor Wolf. Very brief question for both of you. I'm concerned about the image of our country, of the United States, around the world today, considering the fact that I think Professor Grewal talked about our culture and our lack of control in many quarters in terms of gun control, and the fact that maybe you all heard today about another massive shooting in which 12 people were killed at the U.S. Naval Base in Washington. And I'm concerned about our credibility. I mean, whether or not, sure, we have great military power, but in terms of what we represent of our, so to speak, moral compass, or what we think we represent, our exceptionalism, as far as you all are concerned, I'm wondering if this is really now taken, at the very least, with a grain of salt, or even the fact that we really don't have that credibility anymore, that we can talk about moral sway and things like that.
Really good question, thank you. I will say that it has been globalized, interconnected media means that you do occasionally, now and then, hear voices from other parts of the world. And the more of those that you hear, the more you will hear questions about the US's exceptionalism and its moral compass, right? So what people, even Putin's op-ed in the New York Times was interesting because he's taking this, he includes something about sort of questioning US exceptionalism right there in the op-ed page of the New York Times, right? So we have a very different sort of media, globalized media terrain now that makes it possible, makes it very difficult to keep up a certain kind of, you know, notion of exceptionalism, et cetera. At the same time, as I think military power, I think, enforces that exceptionalism as imperial exception, right? Rather than as exceptional in its moral compass, right? The kind of whole humanitarian project is something that's not just American, though. It's much more a Western sort of idea of morality that has emerged more recently, more powerfully.
Thank you.
Turn the lights on.
I actually did that on purpose so that when I speak, light comes in. Can you hear me, Vijay?
Yes.
How's Beirut?
It's warm and delightful.
Excellent. Thank you all for coming and for staying. And I would like to start first with the, I would like you to join me in prayers. I'm just joking, okay. All right, my words will proceed from a realpolitik perspective in the coming few minutes. And I would like to do that because I don't wish to address the question of the United States' right to bomb another country as a serious question. I will assume what is given in the international global scene as a given and proceed from there. I will talk in more, perhaps in more simple ways than my colleagues have in addressing the question at hand. I will read in order to finish on time, and I really look forward to an engagement with the audience on questions that that will come up. As the Syrian refugee population tops 2 million, and as Vijay said, the displacement has reached more than 7 million, and after more than 100,000 killed, and some say this is a conservative estimate, the issue of an impending strike on Syria and everything that surrounds it acquires a lot of weight, considering the potential consequences, political, humanitarian, and so on, notwithstanding the kind of quote-unquote deal that was reached in the past few days. What we are witnessing in Syria today is much more than a brutal is a particular crisis at hand, and we can discuss it as such without disconnecting it from its context, which I will try to address in whatever time I have. The truth is that political actors that might play an effective role in mitigating this human tragedy are in short supply. To depend on a regime, the Syrian regime, that has depressed Syrians for decades and wreaked havoc with the population even before the uprising became fully militarized and internationalized is futile. To rely on the sense and sensibility of an opposition that is replete with opportunists, extremists, and often equally brutal elements is equally futile. And to rely on some of these regional actors that we keep hearing about that are too close to and or deeply involved in the Syrian crisis, not to mention that they are nearly all in dire need of cleaning up their record of human rights abuses, is also futile. Unfortunately for ordinary Syrians, the remaining option is what is called the international community, and as I will discuss towards the end, potential regional options that are not necessarily always obvious or always on the table. This international community, with its good, bad, and hypocritically ugly, is now sort of at the forefront and attempting to do something, in quotation marks. Enough has been said, for instance, about the severe double standards of the United States Middle East policy when it comes to supporting horrendous regimes and policies, and in all likelihood, next to nothing can be expected from Russia and China in relation to human rights, except only the United States has been regularly invading and bombing countries in the region since 2001. So there's not much to expect there. But a configuration based on a common interests, local and international and regional, can be possible, just as non-democrats can come together and compromise to create the kernel of a democratic process or polity as a result of self-interest, so can problematic actors that we have mentioned. So I do not think that because these actors are all problematic, we should just write them off and look elsewhere. I think realpolitik, the real world and history tells us otherwise. But we should not raise our hopes. It is in this context of a humanitarian tragedy and lack of political will and candidate credibility that we must address the folly of the entire situation at hand, including the still on the table potential of America's bombing of Syria. For a variety of reasons, talk of such an act is wrongheaded and potentially disastrous, full of blind spots on the moral, political, and military levels. Even from an uncritical standpoint, it is simply counterproductive. It will suffice to discuss the issue of international and regional will and the issue of effectiveness that has been brought up to address this this potential that we are still in the midst of, despite what we have seen in the past few days in terms of a deal, in terms of the UN results, which, of course, as you might have heard, have only confirmed that chemical weapons were used, but not by whom. It is not for nothing that President Obama was grasping for straws, and the Russian approach actually saved him for now. For good reason, the UK and other powerful regional and international actors are either hesitant, skeptical, or opposed to any serious intervention or strike. This coalitional background should raise serious flags inside any American administration or hall of power, even from an instrumentalist perspective, with many of its members directly funding the rebels, including Saudi Arabia and Qatar, even the Arab League, which suspended Syria's membership and generally pushed for sanctions against the regime, failed to do more than condemn the use of chemical weapons. And of course, there were countries that opposed any serious action of any sort. Surely they recognized the volatility and perhaps futility of such a move, considering their geographic proximity. Therefore, this is not just a bad idea in principle. However, the culprit, according to a logic of consequences, the prospects proceed from grim to tragic. On the question of effectiveness, it is important to ask this. Effective for whom? Every time we hear people, politicians, talk about effectiveness, those who felt we, or the United States, was prepared for the war and in the post-war period, and those who felt that the United States was not prepared, as opposed to some of us who basically rejected the entire logic or option. On the question of effectiveness, it is important to ask that following question, because if we are connected and concerned about the well-being of Syrians, the Syrian people, such a an intervention of any sort that we have been listening to might bring more devastation to them on many counts. First, by President Obama's admission, the strike would have been limited in scope, which means, as BJ said, it will not alter the balance of power, it'd be like a theater, and would probably embolden all actors to ratchet up the violence and mayhem and prolong the war at the expense of Syrians, supposedly the target of any kind of intervention or solution. Clearly, too, an intervention or strike is not intended to deplete the stockpile of any existing chemical weapons, nor can it, considering the various reports about chemical weapons or agents that have been smuggled through Turkey via the opposition. And that is, of course, now supposedly not on the table because the existing deal stipulates that the Syrian regime is supposed to identify a stockpile of chemical weapons and destroy it in due time, which also sounds like theater from beginning to end, and from the regional to the local to the international aspect of this. It is also problematic to consider such an intervention in light of the idea that the opposition can henceforth abuse this situation by crying wolf in the future. And that is something that has not been discussed enough on our fantastic mainstream media here in the United States, along with a litany of other issues that simply do not make the airways. Geographic and demographic factors as well pose a challenge that is orders of magnitude more complicated than, for instance, the case of NATO intervention in Libya. The potential slap on the face that has been discussed then can be inordinately costly and tragic. So in that sense, we should not talk about effectiveness for either the Syrian people or for whatever the goals that are set are. Finally, one need not listen to the proclamations of various people in the region, including the Syrian president, Bashar Assad, who in a recent interview basically talked about how the strike can have volatile regional effects by bringing new players into the conflict and so on and so forth, creating a spillover effect. This too will be a detriment to the Syrian people. With tensions running high between Israel and Iran, vendettas from the 2006 war lurking in the Israeli decision makers' psyche and in op-eds, longer range missiles acquired by Hezbollah in the past few years to go along, and a coterie of takfiri or jihadists groups looking for mayhem so they can make their mark from Lebanon to Syria to Iraq and beyond, such an assault and such a prospect of intervention in that manner is undeniably irresponsible and foolish, now and later. It is not inconceivable that the existing regional tension, political, sectarian, might be the host for an entirely new context that can be set off by an operation or bombing gone wrong. This is not to sound unnecessarily alarmist. We have a tendency to jettison that what's on the table today is a military option in case of the failure of the existing quote-unquote deal that will strike a sovereign nation amid a sea of hostility and firepower. The fact that Obama and the administrations were saved by the Russians is simply a diversion, or potentially a temporary diversion. What, in the end, can one take from this entire tragic web of realities and contingencies? Perhaps the most significant takeaway in the face of a potential is the fate of a potential solution in the event of external intervention or an external military strike. Whatever else such a potential strike might or might not do, it will foreclose the most profitable paths to a political solution by hardening positions further or by bombing the country in a way that would eliminate any prospect for a non-military solution. And I think that you will not hear the last of this potential external intervention simply because of what we are witnessing today. So we will get back to this square at some point in the future. If the will for such a political solution exists among nations like the United States and Russia in particular, this crisis can be used to advance or to bring all parties to the table so that all may compromise, including the United States and Russia, on matters that have long harmed the region and its peoples. And that is, of course, over and beyond the kind of agreement that took place between the Russians and the Americans regarding chemical weapons. This is not the solution for anything, actually. If you look at the mayhem that has taken place in Syria, the humanitarian tragedy, the killing of more than 100,000 people, the idea of destroying chemical weapons doesn't really create any solution for most Syrians, and probably for all Syrians, minus the people that were killed with chemical weapons, which is a very, very small fraction. The investigation into the use of these weapons gives relevant parties the continuing investigation, which should actually take place beyond the fact that we have confirmed that the use of chemical weapons, gives relevant parties a good reason to move forward with a political solution that goes far beyond what we have witnessed so far. But the will and readiness to compromise by all actors involved must be led, in my view, by those who have the most power, and in this case, for good reason. Unfortunately, instead of effecting or even aiming for a more comprehensive solution, we now have this limited and very inadequate deal, again, between the Americans and the Russians, the fate of which cannot be known, nor will its realization, again, change much in terms of the Syrian tragedy. So it looks like we must look elsewhere for now for anything resembling a solution and or cessation of bringing Syria, for anything that resembles a solution regarding the Syrian crisis, because what is happening today is not simply the prospect of the fall of the regime, but also the fall of Syria as a country with its social fabric, and that is the major tragedy over and beyond the question of politics, the question of Syrian regime versus opposition. We are back to square one, but maybe it is time to look for answers deep within the region, not outside of it. As grim as this prospect may appear, there are ways to move forward in that direction. I think Vijay talked a little bit about some of these possibilities, but I do think at this point we have to look elsewhere because the other candidates have been extremely inadequate in their pursuit of a solution. Some of us actually doubt the sincerity of many foreign actors, especially the United States, in wanting to pursue a solution. As many of us have discussed, such a transition or such a total solution would actually only come about as a result of serious compromises, and it doesn't seem that the United States is willing to make any compromises in terms of its hegemony or interests in the region, and that at least should make us aware about the disingenuous rhetoric regarding humanitarianism and any kind of political solution in Syria. Hence, the entire strike idea is really much more about prolonging the civil war or the war, and much less about anything else. And from a cynical perspective, we're looking at a civil war that involves most of Syria or most of the United States enemies. So from a realpolitik perspective, just like Kissinger said vis-a-vis the war between Iraq and Iran in the 1980s, the longer the war lasts, the better it is for American interests. We don't have to be as cynical, but it is not off the table as a potential explanation for the kind of hesitance and the kind of inaction that's taking place.
medical school that's sort of being spearheaded by a friend, his name is Mustafa Mustafa. Nur Kibbi is a fourth-year medical student who grew up in Beirut, Lebanon. She's been interested in health and access for underserved communities. As an undergraduate at Harvard University, she organized certain medical missions to Ecuador, which was one of the major reasons why she wanted to go to medical school. She also volunteered in Palestinian refugee camps in Lebanon. So for 5 or 10 minutes, she'll explain sort of this project that's emerging from the medical school.
I think these like intellectual discussions are very important, and more than anything, I think they underscore sort of the hugeness of this humanitarian issue. I see some of these Syrian refugees at the clinic where I volunteer, the refugee clinic. But my friend Mustafa is actually in the throes of it now. He is a fourth-year medical student, and he is at 1 hour south of Gaziantep in a little town called Kilis. He is volunteering at a polyclinic that is staffed by 5 physicians. They see 350 to 400 patients a day. The pharmacy is pretty much out of medications. The situation is pretty dismal. Just to give you sort of a couple of anecdotes to bring this more sort of into fresh in your minds, Mustafa writes, this is one of 2 anecdotes that I'm going to relate. The first one being, an elderly woman comes in and after her visit asks the doctor for milk for her 5-month-old grandson. He tells her there is no more formula in the pharmacy. She tells him, you know me and you know that I don't ask, but the miskin, the poor boy, is hungry and is just 5 months old. He apologizes and tells her to try coming on Friday and if not, to give him cow's milk. Mustafa writes, you quickly get used to such stories, but it wears on you deep down. The second story is actually a little bit even more frustrating than the first one, if that's possible. 2 hours into seeing patients, I broke one of my general rules of engagement regarding not meddling in individual patient cases. A 14-year-old boy was shot in the stomach 2 months ago in Syria and had part of his colon removed by Syrian surgeons. Today he comes into clinic after several days of worsening pain, which has gotten to where he has difficulty walking. On exam, the skin around his scar was red, hot, and draining pus, indicating an infection that can quickly become life-threatening. Here's the kicker. The clinic is out of antibiotics. There was one last dose which his mother took, and the doctor prescribed her more to get from an outside pharmacy. I explained to her that this is serious and that she needs to get the medicine. I asked her if she would. She looked down in shame and admitted that she wouldn't because she had no money. She said her son was the only breadwinner in the family. So with that kind of in mind, Mustafa has started this online fundraising website, and I can share that with you guys if you're interested. Today we have raised over $3,500 with the goal of achieving $10,000 that would stock up the pharmacy for 2 months, which is actually, to put it more into context, is actually less than the average cost of one night in an intensive care unit in the US. Mustafa is very keen on dispensing the funds himself. He has had much experience in projects like this, having done United to Heal, which is a project that he founded while he was at the University of Michigan, which collected the excess medical supplies from local hospitals and transported them to underserved communities in Ghana and Tanzania. He writes a lot about this kind of work, and he's obviously a medical student that is often in situations and contexts where he is given much responsibility, which obviously as medical students you're not worthy of such responsibility at that point. And so he writes about these kinds of issues. He also writes on issues about medical tourism and the difficulties of wanting to be helpful and also recognizing that this is a situation in which you're just basically adding maybe a drop of change into an ocean of need. And then he also writes on pictures and is very, very eloquently putting it in words of exploiting photographs to attract more readers or even to raise humanitarian funds is unethical, and more fundamentally, it is the separation of that person's dignity. And so our efforts are basically without pictures, with much awareness of the fact that we are helping some people, but only a drop in this ocean of need. With that, we basically are putting forth this fundraising effort to stock up this pharmacy and help these people. So let me know if you're interested. I guess, Dina, do you have the website that you can share with me? Okay, great. So, be able to talk to you.
So, just a few housekeeping things. I'm going to put my laptop right here in the front of the stage. Just put in your email address in a blank email, and I'll be sending you the links to where you can donate to the clinic, and also some more information about the student group collective that is organizing this event. So with that, Chris is going to go around and collect questions, and hopefully we can...
We have about 30 minutes.
Also, please keep them short and questions.
I have two questions. My first question is, beyond the pretext of chemical attack and beyond the goal of prolonging the conflict, what is the actual, does the U.S. think is in its interest in the outcome in Syria and the region? I was at a town hall meeting led by the third highest Democrat in the U.S. Congress, Larson, who casually mentioned that maybe Syria will be partitioned out of this. My second question is, I would very much like both Vijay and Dr. Haddad to talk about, I don't know what the proper word to use is, but the shift in the opposition from the original sort of democratic uprising to the force today, and to delineate as clearly as you can what you think the military force today actually consists of. I'm very active in the anti-war movement, and we need to be sure and able to explain this fully to people who have been on every side of the conflict in Syria in order to build trust and the momentum and inspiration to tie the hands of Washington.
Oh, do you want one at a time?
Yeah, let's take a couple more. Why not?
Stanley Howard here, and my question is, what, as college professors, what would get an anti-war movement going in the colleges? At this university in the 70s, in 1970, there was so much activity and so many demonstrations that the administration closed the university for a week. That was 1970. In 1980, over apartheid, there was 1,000 people in Beinecke Plaza at one point in the struggle. In 2003, there wasn't much there, and I don't know what's here now. And so the question is, what can be made on college campuses?
Other questions?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Anybody else? Okay. In 2010, Obama made the biggest weapons deal in American history, $60 to $90 billion with Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia, as we know, is a major funder of what the media here calls the moderate opposition to Assad. So my first question is, how do we educate the American people, because we're here, as to the sinister nature of the American government in the Middle East. A government that arms an absolute monarchy, and the only government in the world that does not submit women to drive, okay, the American government is obviously a criminal government. No matter who we're for in the Middle East or in Syria in particular, it's our job to educate the American people, because we're here, about who America supports and what it says about the government of the United States.
Was a week and a half ago, the Examiner came out with an article about a faction or a group in the FSA accepting responsibility for the chemical attack. I would like to ask if you guys can sort of demystify the FSA, the various groups within the FSA, and perhaps talk about the legitimacy of the Examiner article.
Maybe
Vijay, could you respond to some of those?
I didn't get the last question.
It's okay.
Well,
just go the way you want.
Well, you know, let's face some plain facts. It's very easy to look out at the Middle East and see Saudi Arabia and conjure up all our fantasies of, you know, barbarism and atavism, etc. But let's face some facts. The United States is a very peculiar country. It itself has this tendency to lean towards all kinds of nasty fundamentalisms, narrow kind of cultural particularisms. You know, it's after all a country where Rick Santorum ran for president, and where, you know, people believe in all kinds of nasty things about UFOs and such like. So when we approach Saudi Arabia, I think it's probably a better idea. And in fact, the question of what is often called Islamic fundamentalism, I think it's a good idea to approach it with a grain of, you know, some self-reflection. That these are not, you know, I'm just trying to say, let's not conjure a vision of the great Oriental satrapy, you know, that is somehow netted the United States, this great innocent actor, into the net of the Saudi, you know, worldview. The United States is a pretty peculiar country as well, so is its other great bureaucratic ally in West Asia, which is Israel, you know, which is
one by one, most Arab countries have actually shifted positions or began to toe the line of the United States, including, lastly, Muammar Gaddafi in, after 2005, who decided to literally buy off the Europeans by paying for the act that he ordered, which is the blowing of a civilian airplane. And of course, President Bush ended up calling Muammar Gaddafi a model for other Arab leaders because he turned in or destroyed his what I call his chemistry set, but you know what Bush calls his weapons of mass destruction. So what remained were countries like Syria and Iran and non-state actors like Hezbollah. So one of the interests of the United States has been to actually reduce the kind of impediments that these countries cause, because at some level they are impediments, they're very strong impediments in some cases, especially for the belligerent position of Israel in the region, and especially in Lebanon, in the case of Hezbollah. So there is this kind of interest in cutting Syria as a regime down to size in a way that will actually weaken Iran and, of course, in connection, weaken Hezbollah. One of the reasons why we are led to potentially accept the logic that a long war is in the interest of the United States is because it actually kind of does that without any serious resources spent by the United States, which, of course, everyone here should know that when we are talking about U.S. involvement in Syria or intervention, we're not just talking about a strike or no strike. There is already a lot of involvement on the ground, covert and visible. And of course, these things cannot always be ascertained, but it's not the first time that the United States is involved covertly in local conflicts. In Lebanon, it actually commissioned the blowing up of cars and all kinds of other operations. One in 1986, when they tried to actually assassinate Sheikh Mohammed Hussein Fadlallah, and they failed. That was just one example. And of course, at the time when people talked about the CIA involvement and put CIA banners in Lebanon's buildings where the attack took place, they were dismissed as left-wing nuts and anti-imperialist, orthodox people who are talking conspiracy theory. So it's important to, on the one hand, not to give in to conspiracy theory. It's actually very important. And on the other hand, not to consider some of these scenarios far-fetched in terms of U.S. involvement already in Syria. But these are some of the potential interests, because the resistance axis that is made up largely of course, Syria, Iran, and Hezbollah is one of the few things that extantly stands in the way of U.S. re-domination establishing its hegemony in the region after the uprisings kind of are going in their own trajectory. And we are seeing also, I think we should all note that there is a counter-revolutionary movement within the region and with allies of established states like Saudi Arabia outside the region, in trying to make sure that whatever the Arab uprisings have produced, and trying to make sure that it is contained. And you will see efforts in the coming years in which the fruits of the uprisings will be either reversed or challenged by the conservative Arab bloc states and its allies outside the region. So the Syria question is one of them, but maybe the bigger question for the United States is also Iran, and I would actually heed the comments that Vijay shared about Iran. The trajectory of the uprising in military terms, I'm assuming this is a question about how things developed in Syria in military terms between the state and the opposition. In the very beginning, contrary to what some would like us to believe, the uprising was actually civilian in the very beginning, and it developed see them uprising against the dictatorship. But nonetheless, early on, it was civilian for the most part. And the regime treated this uprising in a very early on in a very brutal manner that is not uncharacteristic of how it deals with dissent. With time, of course, we began to see the uprising spread from the rural countryside where it started, and we should recognize that this is where it started, not in the metropolitan cities. With time, you had an uprising that was beginning to gain ground in the smaller cities like Homs, and then it began to develop into something a lot more than it was early on, as a result, in part, of the regime's brutal repression of the civilian aspects of it. But it also developed and spread as a result of a very quick interjection of funds and support from conservative Arab countries and from Turkey. Now, at that moment, within the first 8 months of the uprising, you began to see the potential, at least in the first 6 to 8 months, of the uprising actually not overtaking the regime, but potentially causing a serious threat. The continued support of the members of the opposition and the hijacking of the external opposition by countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Turkey, with the support of the United States, whereby the external opposition was actually hijacked in a manner that reflected the interests not of ordinary Syrians or of the opposition in general, but the interests of the patron state, which prevented the inclusion of opposition groups in the major opposition, external opposition. They rejected the inclusion of opposition groups that rejected external intervention, which means that from the very beginning, the opposition was doomed because of international and regional control of various important aspects of it. And that, on the one hand, coupled with the injection of resources and weaponry into the local Syrian opposition from various sides, including pushing the more hardline elements, the more extremist elements, including the repression by the regime that actually itself generated more opposition and more extremism. You had a situation where the opposition and the uprising within 6 to 8 months became quickly militarized. The moment that the opposition or the uprising became militarized in Syria within the first year to year and a half, you began to see people concerned about where the opposition is going, not just in terms of civilian versus military uprising, but also in terms of how members of the opposition were actually not responsive or heeding the original sentiments of the uprising, which were more democratist and became a bit more complex in a way that did not mesh well with the ordinary Syrian. What I'm trying to say is that the militarization of the opposition and the militarization of the uprising actually created a situation where the swing voters in Syria began to actually not support the regime again or support the status quo. That didn't happen, and I still don't think it happened, but you began to see a huge section of the Syrian people until today who are against the regime, but are not willing to flow in the lot with an opposition that has lost its way or that has gained or included elements that are now completely detached from the original sentiments of the opposition and the original values, whatever these were, we can discuss them, but they were certainly anti-authoritarian, anti-social and economic injustice, because the regime also pursued neoliberal reforms that impoverished Syria. So we began to see that kind of a huge swing vote in the middle, kind of not only not going in either direction, but also having no role to play. The only people you heard about and the only members and groups you heard from are those with the loudest guns and the most guns on both sides. So one thing about the military situation in Syria and the opposition and the uprising that we should recognize is that the civilian component of the original uprising has been totally marginalized, and nobody talks about that. There will not satisfy with the other questions that were answered. The Examiner article, I'm not sure about the Examiner article and the idea that the opposition actually, these are speculations. Maybe Vijay has heard. Vijay, have you heard about the Examiner article that talks about FSA?
There was the last question, I didn't hear
it was a two-prong. Can you hear me, Vijay? Hello? Can you hear me? Just nod your head if you can hear me. Yes, great. So the question was that it was actually an NPR. It was originally like an NPR reporter had reported through the Examiner that a group within the FSA had accepted responsibility for the chemical attacks. My question was, one, could you perhaps demystify what the FSA and the various groups within it, and perhaps explain how many of the, you know, 100 and X groups are not on the same page, and two, talk about the legitimacy of the article in sort of juxtaposition to, like, right after the chemical attacks, all of the media coverage that assumed that the regime was responsible for the chemical attack.
And we could take
I didn't see that article, but I saw another article that said that the rebels were responsible. But, you know, like what Bassam was saying, I think this is a red herring. The fact is that over 100,000 people have died. The United States has chosen this as an important event, not only because it is an important thing, I mean, maybe 1,000 people have been killed in this one attack, but because in August, Mr. Obama said that, you know, I guess even then, bumbling through the Syrian policy, he said that if there is a chemical attack, that is a red line. And it's my feeling that this idea of red lines is a very dangerous idea. It traps you to a certain policy. He was going to assume that there was going to be a chemical attack a year after he set a red line. And on the other hand, the lobby that stands up as the great defender of Israel is terrified that if the United States doesn't maintain perhaps this red line, what will it do when the red line that Mr. Netanyahu has set is not met? So there is some business of the red lines here, which these entities take overly seriously. I mean, the fact is, 100,000 people have been killed. This is a catastrophe. And I think the Obama administration was, in a sense, concentrated on this event. And then this event leads to a so-called self-righteous military strike, because it's actually not prepared to deal with the totality of the Syrian conflict, which I think Bassam and I agree that there they are bleeding Syria. And that seems to be, by all understanding of the empirical reality, that seems to be the unspoken policy of the United States government. So this chemical thing, this is about responsibility to protect, this is about American self-righteousness. These doctrines are evangelical doctrines. These are not doctrines of morality. As I said earlier, if the United States was truly morally moved by the catastrophe in Syria, then a lot more than 33 Syrian refugees would have been taken into the United States and taken care of. You know, out of 2 million who have left the country, only 33 have entered the United States. 99,000 are in Egypt, 680,000 in Lebanon, 500,000 in Jordan, etc. Only 33 in the United States. I would say, rather than fight the argument over who fired those chemical weapons, why not concentrate on this argument? Where is the United States' actual humanitarianism?
We have five more minutes, or time for maybe one or two more questions. Are there others, especially those who might not ask questions?
I will take Greer forward.
Okay, thank you. I wish we had actually a little more time, but I wanted to question or ask for maybe clarification on some of the characterization of the so-called you look at it, you know, there were, when the protests began, much of the coverage was on a station called Arana TV that was formed in London in 2009, and through WikiLeaks, we've seen that was funded and created essentially by the CIA, National Endowment for Democracy. But that was the network responsible for getting the majority of the coverage of the original protests out. We also know that in 2007, the Movement for Justice and Development, also not based in Syria, but made up of Syrians who had left the country, was given $5 million by the CIA. We know also that in 2012, there was a constitutional referendum to address many of the issues from the original protests in Syria, including some of the protests that started in Homs and other cities, as well as the countryside. And the SNC, the Syrian National Council, again, based outside of Syria, based in European countries, called for a boycott of that constitutional referendum. So I want to ask, what if we can get some more information, maybe on the initial character of that opposition, because it doesn't seem like it was Syrian at all.
To keep that in mind. It doesn't make it easier for us to think about people who are turning against dictator. I feel like maybe that's something that we have sort of been overshadowed by these other concerns, and I think maybe it's important to keep it in mind, especially when we think about what we want later for Syria.
Okay. I may just address some of these questions. I'll start with the easiest one, the responsibility for the attack that you discussed is not, I mean, I'm not sure what you're responding to. I never said it's like a huge mystery, nor did I beg any of my serious comments on it. I simply talked about the actual response, whether or not the regime has done it. So I do not think the regime is beyond doing it. I do not think parts of the opposition are beyond using chemical attacks. And I do not think the US or Iran or Israel are beyond doing anything like that or affecting or creating the same effect. So I'm not trying to absolve anyone. So I don't think that's, like you said, I don't think that's material. The issue on the ground is, the issue right now is potential response or not, which I think at this point is postponed for a bit. The characterization of the Syrian opposition and whether the gentleman who asked about, you know, doubted the, I mean, have you been to Syria? No. Okay, I'm just asking, I'm not saying if you didn't go to Syria, you can't talk about Syria, I'm just asking about experientially. You know, you could actually piss in your pants if you're in Syria and somebody knocks on the door from the Mukhabarat without having done anything. You could be a priest, you could be Mother Teresa, and you will piss your pants because of what happens on a daily basis for 40 years in Syria as a result of the, you know, just the kind of political climate there. So there needs not be external intervention for people to want to actually oppose the regime. The fact that there has been a lot of external interference that actually created a huge momentum locally doesn't mean that there aren't a majority of Syrians who would like a different life, unless we think Syrians are perfectly happy or were perfectly happy with the existing status quo, and that's not the case. Early on, the Homs is a latecomer to the Homs has nothing to do with the origin of the uprising. The uprising started in Dira, in the south, and it was not about removing the regime. It was not against the regime or against Bashar or against anything like this. It started as demand for basic economic rights and an opposition corruption that was basically targeted specifically against corrupt officials or para-officials like the president's cousin who owns or controls more than 25 to 30% of private assets in Syria as a function of political dirigism. So there's no question there. The debate, even between myself and many others, is not about whether it started as something that's local. The debate is when did it actually transit into something else. That's a legitimate debate. Did it happen in the first month, or did it happen after 2 or 3 months, or after 6 months, and so on and so forth? That is something that we can argue about. It's less important right now because the intervention did take place, and in my view, the uprising was short-circuited, if not hijacked. It doesn't mean there are no elements in Syria that are not connected to outside powers, but it does mean that if you're not connected to outside powers and outside funding, your impact is limited. And then you can take it from there and rationalize however one likes. The question on what is happening on the ground and what should we do, I'm just sharing here that in the past 2.5 years, I spoke more than 100 times at conferences and places like this, and community centers, and mostly universities. And every time I get this question, I say the same thing, and I've said the same thing in the 1990s when I spoke, much less though, and after the Iraq War in 2003, and after Israel's war in Lebanon in 2006. And I always say that we should consider democracy, quote unquote, actually function properly. The responsibility of the attack, I have already addressed that. I would like to give Vijay an opportunity to address these questions, because I don't want to take up a lot of time, and I know that you said 5 minutes, and I over stuff of my time. Vijay?
No, I accept everything you said it very well. I just put the last point you made in a slightly different way, which is that, you know, I understand the imperative people feel of solidarity, to have solidarity with people struggling, particularly if they have ideologies that you agree with. And sometimes, even if they don't have ideologies you agree with, the act of solidarity is a very important and beautiful thing. But the greatest solidarity that Americans can give today for people around the planet is to fight exceptionally hard to lift that thing from other people. That is the biggest boon of the net struggle.
BJ,
political conflicts in Syria. If that ambitious boon is lifted, enormous possibilities have been provided for people around the planet. That has to be the proximate goal of people in the United States.
Vijay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Right at the moment when you said the most important thing is, we lost you.
The most important thing is.
Speakers, especially Bassam S and Vijay Prashad, for staying up till 2 a.m.